Growing up in Hungary, I spent a lot of time at my grandparents' house. And one night we were watching a movie, which became a core moment in my life. And I think partially it even brought me to this stage tonight. I'm pretty sure you all know this movie, so let me give you a clue. In this movie, there is a famous floating wooden door in the ocean. On top of which, there was famously enough space for the male to scoot on top. So maybe he did not have to die in the freezing ocean. Okay, I think we all know that I'm talking about the movie Titanic. And Titanic was a real-life ship that actually sank because of a real-life iceberg, right? And that is probably the only famous iceberg at this point. Do you know where this iceberg originally came from? Not Hungary. So I became very invested, and I ended up becoming a sustainability communication scientist. And I specifically focus on the circumpolar region, so the Arctic. And when I was doing my PhD research, I did some fieldwork, and I went to Iceland, Greenland, and Alaska. And when I was in Greenland, I visited this place called Ilulissat. And it turns out that this iceberg, this very famous iceberg, is believed to have traveled from all the way from Ilulissat to the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. So Ilulissat is famous for its glacier called Sermekujalek. And this is one of the most active glaciers in the world. Every single day, enormous icebergs break off this glacier, and they're crumbling, growling, and they start their journey to the middle of the ocean. So, these icebergs, they are so big. Some of them are 2.5 times as big as the Empire State Building. So, you can imagine this scene, a beautiful scene of floating icebergs, and they look like they've been always there, and they will always be there. And in Ilulissat, I learned that this glacier is now calving. Do you know what that is? Just for those that don't know, calving means that the pressure builds up in the glacier and these big chunks of ice break off. But I also learned that now it's calving, however, soon the scene can become mushy, just like a slushy. Because it's not going to be calving anymore, but melting. And why is it melting? Because of global warming, and I lost you there. Because you will start rolling your eyes, like, not again, another person talking about the end of the world. I already drink my coffee with oat milk, okay? Give me a break. And look, I hear you. But listen, I'm not here to talk about the end of the world. Because our world is not going to end. Probably. But things are about to change, and they are changing faster than ever. And look, I know, we heard all this before, and I'm fully aware of the detours and the hiccups and the wrong turns we are making. But working in this field, I know that millions of people, sometimes intentionally, but even more often, unintentionally, they are working on a concept called planetary health. Planetary health was introduced in 2015, both as a movement and as an interdisciplinary scientific field. And the concept behind it is that human health is inseparable from the health of the natural systems. Our human well-being depends on the air we breathe, the water we drink, and the soil that nourishes our food. Well, that's nothing new though, right? It's not reinventing the wheel. What is new that health might be the argument that catalyzes change. And last November, the World Health Organization published a report in which they asked the citizens of Earth and the organizations working for them to put health in the center of pro-environmental action. Because health is our lived experience of climate change. What I also love about planetary health is that there's not really anything in it that you can deny. That's true, our climate is always changing, but planetary health is about something undeniable. Our shared need for the conditions that let our life on Earth thrive. But if we slow down and truly think about this for a moment, don't you think it's a little bit selfish? Well, what we've been doing as humanity since the Industrial Revolution, or we could rather say the Agricultural Revolution, in the name of survival, efficiency, and expansion, is nothing short of selfish. But understanding why we decided to dominate Earth and each other is not justification, but it can be liberation, because we also never had what we have now. This kind of access to information, this visibility of the consequences, and this abundance of alternatives. We cannot change the past anymore, but we are now more equipped than ever to understand it, digest it, and choose something else. We've never had this vast array of possibilities to help us transition to planetary health. What we do need, though, is tipping points. And you might have heard of tipping points in the climate change discourse, and it usually means that it's a seemingly small shift which results in a transformative shift, which is basically often with the point of no return. So that doesn't really sound like something we want, right? And you might be right about that. And very often when we talk about tipping points in climate change, we think about them negatively. But today I'm going to put that into a little bit of a different perspective. So let's get back to our iceberg for a moment. We've talked about how calving works, but do you actually know how icebergs form? An iceberg is made of ice flakes, and each of them have a unique experience within the glacier. The cracks they followed, the pressure they experienced, and the stillness they held along the way. Each of them are made of their unique patterns, pieces, and layers. What you also might remember from elementary school, maybe, that only 10% of an iceberg is visible, while 90% of it is underwater. By the end of this talk, I think you'll be so knowledgeable about icebergs, I guarantee that. But let me tell you a little bit more about the physics, so stay with me. The position of an iceberg in the water depends on where its center of mass is. That's what keeps its balance. And this balance can shift. It can shift through things like melting or erosion, so it can shift gradually. But it can also shift through things like, I don't know, the Titanic bumping into it while the two main characters were kissing. So suddenly, gradually or suddenly, either way, when the balance shifts, the iceberg will turn around and a whole new part of the very same iceberg will see the light. And what I'm asking you today is to shift your focus, your center of mass towards planetary health. Whether you tip your iceberg gradually or suddenly, that's your choice. Because we need a lot of people who are willing to change gradually, who are maybe willing to swap their milk of choice in their coffee, or who are willing to maybe buy a hybrid car instead of a gas vehicle, or maybe they are just happy to tune into their favorite earthy show on a streaming platform, and that's totally fine. But now more than ever, we also need people who are willing to change suddenly. So if you ever thought to yourself, why nobody has ever written a book about this, or why nobody has ever invented this tool, or why nobody has organized this kind of event, there's a reason why it's in your head and not in someone else's. Do you remember how many different things you need in the ice flake for it to be part of the glacier? It's your skills and your ideas and your perspective that shaped it. So don't wait for permission and don't wait for someone else to come up with your idea. And please, when you tip your iceberg, be loud about it. So the water around you starts moving and it helps others to uncover their hidden potential and their ideas. And look, I know it's very easy to feel inspired at events like TEDx, because it feels like we are under a constellation of bright, powerful talks. But sometimes, just like these lights, your motivation can fade too. And you might ask yourself, why on earth would my contribution matter when at the end of the day, all icebergs will go to the Atlantic Ocean and reunite with the drops of water after melting? But remember, this cycle goes on forever. So from the very same drops of water, new icebergs will form, once again capable of change. So if you ever lose your motivation, you can always turn to nature for inspiration. Good luck tipping your icebergs.